G-E-O. Give us an R-G-E. What do you got? Boy George.
I'm Boy George, and you are tuned to And Another Thing, and today's a very exciting day, because for several weeks I've been trying to get today's guest to come in live to the show. What can I tell you about him? He's got scattercushion lips, he put the an androgyny, but he's not camp, rather like myself, son of an Irish builder. He is Pete Burns, and you tend to hear more about him through myth and gossip. So it's a wonderful opportunity to actually have him in the studio telling me as much as I want to know. It's particularly great to have him in the studio because back in the early 80s, we were like a pair of cats. Joan Crawford and Bette Davis, eat your heart out. We were sworn enemies. But I have to really be honest and say that secretly, underneath the bile, I was actually a very huge fan and I had a lot of respect for him. And even when he was saying nasty things about me, I used to laugh. I always came back with a good retort, but I used to think they were hysterical. Because I think if you're going to be bitchy, be funny. Or don't bother. Welcome, Pete Burns, to And Another Thing. I'm sitting here with Bette Davis, and my name's Joan Crawford. Welcome to And Another Thing. I'm with Pete Burns. Thanks for coming in.
And you think we could have been friends all these years.
I know. I mean, I have to say that if I went back 20 years ago to when I first actually met you in person, I wouldn't sort of believe that, like, this far on, you and I would be sitting in the same room with each other like mirror movies.
weren't we just silly? But you said to me last week, I don't know if you remember, I said, weren't we such... And you said, but weren't we fabulous? Because you don't get the same calibre of today. We were going to be in messy over hairdos and...
What I actually think is that, you know, like, in the old days, when I used to read stuff you said about me, I used to think it was hysterical. I mean, I used to kind of, like, snap back immediately. But it used to make me laugh. I never really got offended. It used to sort of quite excite me, actually.
Oh, you know, I really... Honestly, I'm not saying that because I'm opposite you here. I wish I hadn't bitten the bait, because you know when you're sitting with a journalist, they will antagonise you on a subject, and then eventually you buckle and you say something and it goes in print and it's repeated for...
But I also, if you've got something to say that's bitchy, as long as it's funny, it's cool.
But I wasn't really interested in saying those things. Where we really got off on a bad foot, you and I, aside from the rubbish in the English media, was I was dragged over to America at the time of That's the Way I Like It. I think that was in 1983, and you were just God in America. And I was there to do two concerts that had already sold out at the Ritz, and then suddenly the record company got involved out of the blue, and there was this woman, Susan Blonde.
I remember her well.
Well, I wasn't there on a promo trip, but I was wheeled into the office in front of this really odd lady. And
into a vintage Chanel, I know.
Yes, yeah, and I walked in, and the whole wall, I thought they'd made Boy George wallpaper, that was fine, but on the door was a tiny little blue tack picture of me on your wallpaper, like a stain. And she went, I just want you to know, he's the biggest thing here, and nobody knows what he does in bed, and we don't want to know what you do in bed, and if anyone asks you about him, you say the best things or you're over.
Oh, what a cheek.
But I just got off an aeroplane. People's Express, we paid. It was a real povo trip, you know. And I just wanted to slap her. And then you were this thing dangled in front of me.
It's a very funny story, because when I first ever went to New York, one of the first people I met in terms of my career was the same woman you just talked, Susan Blonde. I'm actually very fond of, but I remember I sort of travelled over there. And I was very anti-American. I'd never been there, so I had a real thing about America because I hadn't been there. Got to New York and I was, like, really bedraggled. I was sweaty. I had no makeup on. I had spots. I looked revolting. I remember walking into her office and she looked at me and she goes, you're so beautiful. And I just thought, you are so full of... Yeah. But, I mean, I got to really like her years later. She's a very sort of interesting character. But sort of before we sort of talk about that, I want to go right back to really early sort of, like, sort of late 70s punk scene in Liverpool, because you were a kind of renowned figure at that time. I mean, I lived in Warsaw for a little while, sort of towards the end of the 70s, yeah, well, sort of just outside Birmingham, and I knew about you. I'd seen pictures of you. In fact, I probably had a couple of pictures in my squat of you on the wall with your rags in the hair. So I knew about you, and I kind of sort of admired you. And Martin and I, you know, because I lived with Martin Degville from Zig Zig Sputnik,
yeah.
We always wanted to come out to Eric's because we knew it was, we heard it was like the club in the north to go to, and we were terrified because of it.
I really don't understand why, because I think then there was a lot less nastiness and hostility going on, but people, I was very scary. People have always found me very scary, and I think my look was very scary, and I think when you keep people at a distance, they interpret your look to match, well, they make a behaviour that matches your look.
I mean, there's a lot of fantastic stories about you, you know, like sort of things that probably aren't true, but they're kind of fantastic stories, you know. I mean, I think for the last 10 years, I've seen you a sort of handful of times, but I've actually heard more about you through kind of just these unbelievable stories. And whether they're true or not, it doesn't really matter.
I hear them, and sometimes they used to really irritate me, and in the case of things like Pop Bitch, that really irritated me, but I'm not going to go into that.
I've had my little fights with them as well.
Yeah, but I didn't know how important that they actually were.
Do you think they're important, though?
Well, no, I'll just briefly run through this. They ran this funny story, and on that morning, my wife's mother dropped dead, and at 9 o'clock, we got the call, your mother's dead. Well, I don't really do death. I was like, someone said, and then Fleet Street were phoning up because they'd read this thing on Pop Bitch, and then we tried to find out who wrote Pop Bitch and found out that they were in hiding and no one really knows who writes Pop Bitch. So we did a bit of investigation and found who wrote Pop Bitch, and we put the number on our website and linked it to 75 other celebrity websites, and everyone was calling Pop Bitch. So then they apologized.
Revenge is a dish best served cold.
They were served, it was steaming cold and wilted, but they were so terrified they begged forgiveness. But I think if you're going to write those kind of things, I really probably would have found it amusing at another time, but it was the morning of a death, and there's never, that's a really bad time to do that.
Well, I always think that sort of press comments, as long as they're not too personal, I don't really mind people dissing my music or dissing the way I look. It's when they start talking about my family or things like that. That's when it bothers me.
Yeah, they bring other people into it. But I think I do. I'm still going through a bit of that defensive thing where I don't understand how people can be so judgmental about things. It's beyond me how they can live with themselves when they write.
Do you think a lot of that stems from the fact that you come across, you know, certainly historically, as someone who doesn't really give a damn what anybody thinks? I mean, I don't know if that's necessarily true, because I think, sort of now I've got to know you a little bit better, so I think that you're a hugely sensitive person, but a lot of people, I used to hear stories like, you know, people would come up to you in the street and you'd just sort off and stuff.
I did that for Marilyn.
Yeah, well, that's understandable.
I know, but I did that. I can remember this day feeling like there was all these phone calls going off. I was playing the Dominion Theatre in London. I think it was possibly before I had a major record deal, and these phone calls were coming through. It's Marilyn. He wants the Royal Box. And they were interrupting me in the soundcheck saying, Marilyn wants the Royal Box. And I wasn't that... I think he'd had a hit then. And, go away. So I was in Covent Garden in the morning buying something, and this guy came scuttling across the road, and it was Marilyn, and he suddenly starts going, why do you hate me? Why do you hate me? And I went, I don't even know who you are. How can I possibly hate you? Why do you hate me? Do you want to hit me?
I imagine that would have offended him far more.
He had a photographer up the street waiting to... I think he wanted me to slap him. He's going, are you going to hit me? Are you going to hit me? And I just went, scram, go away. That was it. That was it, really, that I told somebody to...
I mean, how many of the sort of stories about you? I mean, I'll name a few, and if you don't want to put them on the air,
I don't particularly want to deny or confirm that.
Well, don't deny or confirm it, but there's a fantastic story. I heard this great story that you apparently dug up Sinead O'Connor's garden in the middle of the night, which probably isn't true.
It isn't, but she did live opposite me, and I will elaborate on one story here, because I think she's really quite nice. I don't know.
Oh, she's a brilliant singer. I love her voice.
I really don't know, but she lived opposite me for a brief period of time, and I was friends with Morrissey, and he came to my house, and as you do, you said Sinead O'Connor lives over there. Well, Morrissey was a bit of a troublemaker. I think he's funny, but he really did cause trouble. And on this one particular day, I was going into hospital. I had a kidney stone, which is like really painful, and I didn't know what it was. I thought I was having a baby, and I was leaving to get in this taxi to take me to hospital and find out why I was in this pain, and Sinead O'Connor came running up the path with fists behind her back, and she's going, you've got telescopes trained on my window and you're taking paparazzi photos of me, and I just didn't know what the hell she was talking about. Morrissey told me, and it was just Morrissey's way of having a laugh that Pete Burns lives opposite you and he's watching you. Well, there wasn't anything that interesting to see, because she spent most of her time sitting on the doorstep sobbing in the morning. She was always crying. She was really having a hard time, and Morrissey had done that, and she'd gone off the deep end thinking that I was watching her. But then, if we're going to really be serious, she had no curtains on her windows, and there was candles everywhere, and everybody looked through Sinead's window.
Well, I certainly would have done if I'd lived next door.
Well, I couldn't be bothered, but, you know, I did write her a very in-detail letter about how the pressures of fame, and if she's listening to stuff like that, she should get out now. But, no, I didn't dig up her garden. She didn't have a garden.
So, anyway, moving on from that, if you go back to sort of, you know, early sort of Liverpool, you have quite an extensive musical history. I mean, you're involved in that whole punk scene. How did you feel about the kind of scene in sort of London compared to Liverpool at that time?
I really wasn't that aware of it. I used to come to London to shop, and we used to always go to Vivian Westwood, Malcolm McLaren's shop. That was the only place that I shopped, and it still is, really. And I gathered there was this kind of little army forming in there, but I could never get the time to stay down in London and get involved. And then it seems scary. I still find nightclubs and the whole music scene quite intimidating in its own way.
It's strange to hear you say that you find anything intimidating because you're known as kind of a very intimidating person.
Well, it's just the visuals. I do get nervous if I walk into a club and it's full on. And I can remember that Sex Pistols played in Liverpool in 76 before they were really, you know, known. And going to see them and this in Eric's and meeting the Sex Pistols afterwards, and although they were very nice people, I was very disappointed in what they were doing musically and visually. I thought it was going to be a lot wilder with the association with McLaren and Westwood and the pictures of the people I'd seen in London clubs. And the Sex Pistols to me looked at the time like a bunch of roadies, except for John Lydon. So I was a bit disappointed, and I started to think, there's really nothing out there for me. I'm a fruit that stands alone.
Did you want to be famous at that time? Did you sort of...
Still don't have any desire to be famous. I can't see the benefits of it. I've got to do it to make people aware of the product that I've got. But I really can't see any benefit of being famous.
So do you think is it for you more about sort of, you know, having a great lifestyle and being...
I like
secure.
Secure. If I knew for a fact I was going to drop dead at 58, I probably reasonably wouldn't need to do much work. I've been very lucky in that way, but I've got this idea that I'm going to live to be very old, and it's time now to... When you get to my age, an achy knee takes on sinister connotations.
Oh, you're not that old, Pete.
No, but, you know, no, but you do get older, and you're very aware of the passing of time. When you're meeting this blanket thing from radio and magazines, we can't feature you too old. You know, it's... Well, maybe I am.
Do you think... I don't think it is that, because I certainly, at the moment, sort of don't get invited onto a lot of the shows that I would have done at the height of my career. The more sort of freaky I've got... I mean, I'm not dressed up today, and I apologise for that, because you look fantastic. But, I mean, a lot of... You know, the more you sort of, like... The more you kind of talk about your sexuality, and you're more open about, you know, what you do in your life, the less you kind of become ostracised by that kind of medium, because it is really cheerleaders and sort of Mickey Mouse Club type people. I mean, how do you feel about the sort of media perception, you know, that includes radio, TV, magazines, journalists? How do you feel that they get you wrong?
I really try very hard not to think about it. I haven't had a record out for quite a long time in this country, an official, you know, mainstream release, and I actually don't really read what they've... But always someone's going to tell you what
yeah.
they've written. But I don't actively go out and buy it. If I do an interview, I let it go into print and someone will put it on file for me. But sorry.
We're going to take a break. I'll be back with more Peter Burns after this. Let's take a look at London's roads now with LBC's Lisa Vane.
Thanks very much. Well, it's still a very busy picture for you if you're heading north on the M1. A spate of earlier accidents there, and one of them still in place at Junction 6, the northbound exit slip. So you'll find as a result you've been diverted up to Junction 8 and then back down to Junction 6 again. If you're heading onto the rest of the motorways, pretty busy on the M25 on the Dartford crossing at the moment. That's partly because of people diverting from the Blackwall Tunnel, which was closed earlier, and the QE2 bridge down to about 20 miles per hour from Essex into Kent at the moment clockwise. If you're heading for the Blackwall Tunnel, still just the one lane open southbound after an accident involving a diesel spill at the exit. Rotherhithe also slow after a couple of breakdowns at the southern exit. If you're crossing the river further east, London Bridge is a bad bet because Borough High Street very slow both ways with temporary lights at the Southwark Street Junction. On public transport, lots of weekend engineering in place. You can check that out on our website. LBC 97.3 Travel, your next update in 30 minutes.
Discover Airside with BAA Retail at Stansted, Heathrow and Gatwick. And you could fly away with more than great bargains on perfume, fine wine, spirits and other goods.
LBC 97.3 and BAA Retail are giving you the chance to win day trips to Paris with £100 spending money and £250 to spend Airside. Just listen to LBC 97.3 this Saturday, Sunday and Bank Holiday Monday and you could be flying to Paris.
So make time before your flight to shop with BAA Retail and start packing your bags for Paris with LBC 97.3. Tuned in to London.
You're tuned to And Another Thing, and today my guest is Pete Burns, Liverpool legend. So, Pete, I read this interview with you this morning. I've been doing my research.
That's great.
And you made a comment which I find hard to kind of, like, believe, because you said you don't think music is important, or you were talking about a record that you'd made, and you said that, you know, I'm supposed to say it affected someone's life or people's lives, but I don't think it really does. I mean, if you think that, why do you make music?
Because I've got no plans to have children. It would ruin my figure. And I've got to create it. I'm quite fertile. I've got to create something. And when I'm not creating music, I'm creating myself. And when I'm not creating myself, I'm changing something in the house. And when I'm not changing something in the house, I'm changing somebody's life in some way. I feel the need to create things for me, because they've just got to get out, because otherwise you're constipated creatively, and that can really drive you to...
But, I mean, obviously you understand that if you make records, one of the natural consequences of that is that you're going to be famous or that you're going to be, you know, noticed.
Yeah.
I mean, do you ever, like, for example, I was looking over the balcony and I saw you coming in and I actually thought Steve was you.
Yeah.
I thought, who's that gorgeous girl with me? You know, it's like, it's almost like, you know, but the funny thing about you is you're not camp.
No, I wouldn't. I didn't even move in the gay community when I was a kid. I wasn't allowed. I was too strange. I just wasn't welcome. I can remember with this incredible optimism at the age of 14 or 15 with dyed red hair and shaved off eyebrows, oh, there's a gay club I can go to, and I arrived and they wouldn't let me in, but it didn't stop me dyeing my hair a different colour and trying again the next week. And I can remember always turning up at this door and not being allowed in, and it wasn't until 76 when Eric's opened that I found somewhere that I could go. And I think that camp is contagious, and it's, camp is contagious, and it's a learned behaviour pattern, but I didn't have I had no friends. I didn't have gay friends or queenie friends, so I didn't pick up the behaviour.
Do you think that your sort of, persona, in a sense, is kind of a deliberate, you know, like, you don't want to be kind of, like, considered a cliché? I mean, I'm a bit like that as well, although I have done that. I got to a point in my life and I thought, actually, I don't really want to be like this anymore because it's not really who I am. Mm. But it's almost like when you arrived on the scene, it was like you had me that was kind of like, I was considered a sort of user-friendly puff. And then you had kind of, you know, Pete Burns. It was like there was a kind of fierceness to you, and it was almost like you were more sexual. I don't know if that's true, what you did in your private life, but there was this kind of energy, like with Frankie Goes to Hollywood, Relax, and that whole kind of aggression, sexual aggression they had. It was like you came with this sort of thing, like, you know, there was something kind of dark and dirty about you, but...
Yeah, but I think that at that time as well, it's a certain form of rebellion. If people have this perception of you, you want to really throw it in the face. And the people in the punk days that I really admired are people like Wayne County, when he was Wayne County. And that was one of the first acts that I ever saw. And I thought Wayne County was going to come on in a great big teased up wig, but he dropped that at this time. I was aware of Wayne County through Bowie's main man thing. And I went to see this act called Wayne County, and everyone thought it was going to be a country and western act. And this guy came on, like, with this... like Dietrich makeup and this beret and a dirty old army suit, and he scared the hell out of the audience. And suddenly I thought, well, I can do that too. That inspired me. I didn't copy what he did, but I thought that's what was in me anyway, so there's no need, because I wore makeup, to come on acting like Danny LaRue's younger sister. You could still be manly and wear makeup, because, you know, even you know that sometimes to do what we do, you've got to be more of a man than a lot of these butch.
Well, actually, I say that you're not a man until you've walked in heels, and they're...
No, you're not, and every step you take in a heel reminds you.
I can't really say the rest of the sentence, because it's too dirty for the show.
Oh, I wish I could hear it. I'm not trying to contradict anyone's opinion of me. I'm not trying to fit any role. The one thing that I can honestly say, and God strike me dead if I'm lying, I've always been 100% myself, and I sometimes find that doesn't really work in my favour.
I think that, you know, when you dress up, like for me, as I've gotten older, I remember my mum used to say when I was like 15, oh, we'll grow out of it, but I've got worse. You know, but people assume that if you dress up, you're doing it for them. And I can honestly say in the same respect now, when I dress up, it's not necessarily for anybody else. It's because it makes me feel comfortable. And in terms of what you've done physically to yourself, you know, I was talking to you a couple of weeks ago, and you said that you've never felt more kind of comfortable in your skin than you do now.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably an abstract thing to go on about, but if you give me flowers, I don't like them. I like plastic flowers because they're reliable and the vase isn't going to smell and they're not going to die.
You just don't like changing the water, right?
No, I just don't like that they drop dead and die. I like things that are manufactured and made, and you're in control of them, really. It's not an insecurity about growing older or anything, but I just wanted to make myself into what I probably felt inside. And then when I got to a certain point, I thought, well, I'm bored with that and I'll move along. And It's my right to do it, isn't it?
Absolutely. In terms of your kind of fan following, I mean, you've got a very loyal and kind of dedicated, almost fanatical fan base.
I know. Aren't I lucky? You know,
What sort of things do they kind of ask of you, you know, like on your website? I mean, you spend a lot of time on the website, don't you?
No, I've just started peeping. Started peeping because I couldn't learn to do a computer. And then we got the computer and I started to have a look occasionally on the notice board. And sometimes you get outraged and then you just switch it off.
Outraged by the things that people who say they're fans say about your music.
They're older. They're not kids, and you got to remember that they're older. They're probably all in their 30s. It's not 12-year-olds, but sometimes they appear to talk like 12-year-olds, and I get angry with 12-year-olds very, very quickly.
Do you do what I do? I mean, sometimes I go on my website.
Somebody has, you know what, we've got somebody sometimes said, have you read this on the Boy George website, and they will send back an absolute hateful rant.
For me,
I tell you what, I fell off the computer chair once, because it was going on about Eminem, and it was going on about, it was just the most outrageous load of vitriol, but you must have felt great.
No, I got this message from this guy called Merlin, and it was like, I don't like this song you've done, blah, 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 this and that and the other. And I just went back and said, if you're a real wizard, why don't you stick it up your bum and disappear?
Oh, I think you went a bit further than
that. No, that was the first message. And then he came back and said more. And it was like, first of all, don't come on my website, which is my website, and say you don't like what I do musically if you're a fan. If you don't like it, just don't tell me. I'm not really interested in what you think.
Yeah.
And I also think that, you know, what's interesting when you respond in an honest fashion, that the replies that you get from people is like, oh, you know, you're really nasty and condescending. And then if you're nice, they send things like, oh, you had sex this week.
Yeah, but
that's so personal.
Also, people perceive that I think that we've started off with a bit of a disadvantage. We're almost disabled in people's minds. You know, we're unusual, so we're disabled. So we don't have the same rights to have the same responses to things as other people. For instance, when you had the drug thing, you know, that was fine for everybody, but not for you, because you were disabled in the first place. So everyone was just so happy, go away, and they wouldn't let you back in. And I also think when people criticise you, we're supposed to take it. We're supposed to be used as mops. As, you know, just mop the floor with us. And I'm not very good at playing mop for people, but I won't waste the time typing replies to things like that, you know.
Oh, I don't see it as wasted time. You know, if I'm bored on a Sunday afternoon and there's nothing on telly, I'll happily sit and respond to these people.
I love the ones that I read. They really, really made me laugh, because you're very good at giving a lecture. Very, very good at giving a lecture.
It's
very,
the soapbox, the metaphorical soapbox.
It's a hectoring. Like, it reminds me sometimes of the way Vivian Westwood is, you know, that sometimes she'll go off and lecture somebody and yours are very like that. And there's no way they could argue with it. And of course, you offend them.
Oh, my God, I'm a horrible school teacher. One thing I'm really interested in asking you is sort of about morality, you know, because obviously, people will look at me and think, oh, I'm completely immoral and I don't have any rules about my life. But I do imagine that there probably are some things that you're quite strict about. I'd like to know what they are.
Well, I need to have discipline in my life. I like to meet people who have normal jobs, you know, who have to get up at maybe 10 o'clock and open a shop.
So they're not, like, feeding off you and, you know, getting
I'm just very interested in what's going on in the normal world. It's only relatively recently that I asked somebody who worked in a big designer shop, what is your actual salary? I'm very interested in what people work for. I'm interested in what goes on in the real world. And it's very difficult for me to, I like to watch people, but usually I'm watched.
Yeah.
Watching people. I like discipline, and I don't say that in a spanky bottom sense. I like to say that,
not that there's anything wrong with that, you know.
No, but I like to say, right, I will, for instance, one of my disciplines is exercise. I will go to the gym by 11 o'clock this morning, no matter what else happens, I'm going to do that, and that's my time, and I'll stick to that rule. And I think that the people who live with me sometimes wish that I wasn't so disciplined. I don't think I'm disciplined in a Madonna way, because I can get really, really sloppy.
Yeah.
But there are certain things and certain standards that I won't let slip. Trivia, I've never once in the 150 years I've been alive slept in my makeup. Never. No matter what, if I crawl in, it's removed. Every damn scrap.
What about going out to the public? Do you always dress up when you go out?
It doesn't seem like a dress up to me. It's just something that I do on a daily basis. You'll very rarely catch me in mufti, and if you do, it's because I'm very comfortable that way on that day. But I do like to do something. Everybody in the morning goes, and the first thing most people do, unless they're ill, is go and have a poo. Well, I do that. I go and have a poo, and then I go and put on some makeup. And I've been doing it since I was wearing makeup, probably since I was 11.
When I met Dolly Parton a couple of years ago, she was fantastic, because I walked in sort of like with no makeup on, and she was like, oh my God, is that you? And I was like, yeah. And she goes, you go out like that? And I said, yeah, thanks. And she goes, I'd never go out like that, because I'd be finding someone jumping out of a bush and take my photo. And I said, well, you know, I've kind of got over that. And I think in some respects for me, I mean, even doing Taboo, you know, sharing a dressing room with, you know, quite a lot of fit young guys, you know, good bodies, look good in their underwear. And I'm sitting there in my green tights, my belly's out, and I'm thinking, if you'd have told me 10 years ago that I'd be doing this, I would have laughed in your face. I think for me, you know, so I think for me sort of going out without makeup, you know, I mean, I'd prefer to do it every day, and I'd prefer someone to come and do it for me, like Christy Bateman. But what I'm saying is, you know, I think part of my kind of growing up in a way is kind of going out and saying, you know what, who cares? You know,
well, you think, haven't you got a life? I went to, I think it was one of the department stores, John Lewis. I was going to buy some cream. It was on an early morning thing. I just had a glycolic facial peel, so I was as red as a tomato and starting to break out in little scabs. And the woman behind the counter went, oh my God, what have you done to your skin? And then I didn't feel self-conscious. I just thought, haven't you got a life? You're selling these creams and supposed to cure this, and you're horrified because I've come in looking like Samantha off Sex and the City. When society practically demands that of us, I'm not going to hide away in that condition, and I'm not vain in the fact that I will let people see me all the time like that.
Okay, we're going to take a break and come back for more.
You get the news on LBC 97.3 during the week. Don't miss out at the weekend.
Richard Dallin.
I'll update you each Saturday and Sunday evening. Hear what's happening and what it means and get prepared for the week ahead. It's your complete one-hour guide to news and sport. Saturday and Sunday evenings at 6.
Richard Dallin.
LBC 97.3. Tuned in to London. This is LBC 97.3.
1:30 news, 6 people have been questioned by anti-terrorist police over a suicide bombing in Tel Aviv. Officers are searching the homes of 3 men and 3 women arrested in London, Derbyshire and Nottinghamshire. A murder investigation is underway after the body of a London businessman, Amarjit Chauhan, was found near Bournemouth Pier last month. The Met has named 2 men it wants to question in connection with his death and the disappearance of his family. British diplomats are calling for a full investigation into the fatal shooting of a British cameraman in the Middle East. James Miller was filming in the town of Rafah when he was shot in the neck by Israeli troops. An Australian flight attendant is in isolation in hospital with a suspected case of the SARS virus after working on a flight from Singapore. It follows 18 more deaths from the virus in the Far East. London's weather, sunny spells becoming hazy as the cloud increases this afternoon. Dry and mild overnight, today's maximum 17 Celsius. In Orpington at the moment it's 16 Celsius. LBC 97.3.
I accept some things about the internet. I accept the witty comment I posted it to this morning doesn't seem quite so witty now. I accept that I still can't download a pizza. But I won't accept having to wade through piles of internet magazines trying to choose the right broadband provider.
Choosing the right broadband provider is easy. Where it's available, 3 times more people have chosen Blue Yonder Broadband than BT, Freeserve or AOL. Subscribe to Blue Yonder before the end of May and the first month's free. Call now to see if you live in a TeleWest broadband area. 0800 953 5000. Whatever else you accept, don't accept less than Blue Yonder from TeleWest Broadband. Subject to minimum term contract and conditions.
That old Joel just talking to Pete Burns. He's the one with those lips.
Ooh. You're tuned to And Another Thing, and today my guest is Pete Burns, Liverpool legend. You seem to me to be quite protective of your privacy.
Yeah, because it's all I've got, isn't it? Privacy.
Because I was out with you a couple of nights ago, and someone sort of walks up to you with a camera, and you just totally put your hands in. It's like, no. You look great, but it was like,
yeah,
no.
But I don't want to be, like, I'm out and I'm not performing. I'm just out like they are, and I do find cameras to be relatively invasive. I don't actually particularly enjoy lying around having photos taken.
But it comes back to my point earlier that when you dress up, people think that it's just a bid to get attention.
Yeah, but that's like thinking a woman in a miniskirt is just wearing a miniskirt to get, you know,
sexually assaulted.
Yeah, it's the same way you dress up. I mean, you don't, you don't just brush your teeth because you want people to smell your breath. You just do it. The same with appearance. To me, it's not for them to take photos, and I don't want to be in one of those horrible photographs that they get out on the table. Who's this? Oh my God, doesn't he look weird? I'm not a organ grinder's monkey.
And also, you know, a photograph taken in bad lighting can make you look a lot worse than you do.
Oh, they're horrible. But I don't know what they want it for. I mean, I just don't get it. I'm not condemning them. I just don't get it. I don't know what they want it for.
The thing that I can't stand is when someone comes up to you in a club or outside a TV studio and they've got, like, the most disgusting picture of you, like 50 gins.
Yes,
like, can you sign this? And I go, no. I take it. Someone said, give me your address, I'll send you a nice one.
Yeah, I don't know what they don't see those things, do they? And I guess it's all silly vanity, but that's not the reason. I just don't want to stand around being photographed in a nightclub. I like to talk to people. I mean, I've met you out a few times. I can honestly say since the Daisy Chain days when Lee Bower used to appear and make the whole night go with a bang on his visuals, I haven't had such good nights out as I've had in the last 2 weeks. I've loved them.
Now, would it be fair to say that in the last kind of 10 years, you have changed as a person, majorly. Or maybe it's because I didn't know you before. Maybe
I think it's because you didn't know me.
Because a lot of people don't know you, you know what I mean?
Always, you know when I read your book, I really felt really very sad because I thought, you know, we could have been really good friends.
Well, you know what, it's not over yet, dear.
No, but I did at that time. I thought, what a waste, and everyone else getting involved in it. Because there's not... When people are kind of alike, but different... We're different, but we're alike, and I think we can have good conversations, and we think differently, but ultimately we all come from the same kind of thing. I think it was a big waste, because I felt very alone out there in the
world. Well, I actually think that there are people out there who actually sort of look at you, and probably do the same to me, look at the way you look and think that you're not bright, but actually I've always kind of known that you are very sharp and very intelligent. But the one thing that's really surprised me the last few times I've met you, I was like... He's really sweet. I mean, really charming. No, I shouldn't be surprised by that. But, like, you know, it's interesting, like all my friends, you know, when they've met you, they're always really nice because people expect you to be, like, really scary.
And, you know, sometimes because they expect it so bad, you might as well do it because you can't win. You know, if someone comes up and they start with that kind of, oh, you're going to be horrible to me, and the trembling away, sometimes it's much easier to just be horrible to them and give them what they want.
I had this funny situation, actually, the other night in Nag Nag Nag, because this girl came up and spent... She first came up and said, I'm really sorry to bother you. And 10 minutes of, you know, apologising, blah, blah, blah. And I just looked at her and I said, what is it you want? She said, I want to take a photo. I said, why didn't you just say that?
Yeah, you could have done it.
I really prefer, I don't know about you, but I prefer kind of people just to be direct, you know.
Yeah, I do like them to be direct. And when they are direct, I also realise the amount of courage that's gone into being that direct, so, you know, I'm okay. But when I go out, I'm not so into being bothered. I can't hear what anyone's saying in a nightclub. You really amused me last night by going, loud in here, you know, pretend you had an ear horn, because people talk to you and you're just trying to lip read. And I just really don't know where the conversation goes.
Well, I always think that, like, if you're having dinner or you're dancing, you just don't go up to people and bother them. Because when I'm dancing, it means I'm having fun. Because I don't dance a lot, but when I'm dancing, I'm enjoying myself. And it's like, when someone comes up and pokes you...
Oh, yeah, you got to stop.
It's like, can't you see I'm dancing? Go away, I've taken 2 hours to find a space where I can dance.
Talking about having dinner, my all-time... favourite TV moment was you and Philip Salon on
The Wizard of Oz.
Diners. That was just unbelievable. And when that girl came up and did that freak out in your whole attitude, you could really tell somebody you'd lived. You know, you could have ripped her head off if you'd have wanted to, and you just found it so amusing. And I do think that that's the thing about you that I've noticed, is that you've been through so much, and it's given you, like, this... complete good grace about things.
Oh, and also, you know, I just feel that if somebody... I mean, I used to get that real panic if I was rude to somebody, that was a record sale down the drain. I sell new records for a long time, so I don't care. And, like, you know, when people say to me, oh, I'll never buy another record, I'm like, you didn't buy the last 10.
Yeah, exactly. But you could, particularly from that moment captured on TV, and you had that great hat on with the picture on and everything, and that girl came up, and you just found it so amusing. That really made me realise that we've all been through a journey, and we don't respond in the same way, but we're confident that if the need arises, that we can defend ourselves both.
Oh, totally. I mean, I think that, you know, there are times when I feel that people come up to me and maybe they're expecting me to be rude or... I don't know, they've got some idea of me. And if they say the wrong thing to me, I can be very nasty. But I don't feel bad about it anymore. I used to feel terrible when I was 27, when I was 35. No, I don't care. When I got to 40 and I had my birthday party, I remember thinking, you know what? I'm not taking any nonsense of anyone tonight. I don't care. If I don't want to talk to anyone, they can go away. And people would come again, you know, drunk, kissing me. And I was like, just leave me alone, I'm 40. Leave me alone. When do you think sort of change for you sort of happened? Because there has been a change, you know,
Before 40, I'd say probably 30. I suddenly felt grown up at 30. Although I was perfectly able to trivialise everything and be a snappy bitch if I wanted to be. I like to go with what I'm feeling, and there are good days and bad days for everybody. I'm not a professional, pleasant person, because some days I just don't feel...
What do I call it? I call it organised sincerity, the kind of thing that Jerry Halliwell has.
Isn't she good at it? Isn't she good at it? I mean, I don't know, it makes you cringe because you know what goes into it, but there are professional people who do that, and they do it so damn well, and it's a skill like dancing ballet, isn't it?
Yeah, no, it doesn't really wash with me, though. I sort of look at those people and think, you know, like the Ronan Keatons and the kind of, you know, Jerry Halliwell, and just think, oh, Val Dunican.
Yeah, I don't look at them and feel, you know... I respect for it, but I see that that is the biggest part of the job now, of making records. The fame and the celebrity and being pleasant is so much more important now than writing your record or even singing on your record.
It's a very interesting point, because I was... I actually had the very nice pleasure of sort of having dinner with David Bowie last year, and I'm, you know, as you know, I'm a huge Bowie psychopath. And I was sitting there talking to him and with Iman, and I was like, because I also love Angie Bowie.
Yeah, I just got her book again backstage.
Oh, I actually communicate with her, so I'll pass your email on to you. She's brilliant. She's such a laugh. Really mad. But obviously, I'd never tell David that I'd speak to her because I don't think he'd like it. But David was saying to me, oh, tell Iman about the time when Angie told you to, you know, F off outside my house. Oh, yeah, when I was about 13, I was out there with a load of kids.
And look what happened, the revenge. It happened to you.
Exactly, but it was so funny. I was standing with all these, like, fantastically dressed Bowie clones. I was looking a bit sad, you know, me sort of spit knee loons and me sort of embroidered shirt. And she opened the window and she goes, why don't you all just F off, bleep? And I was thinking, you can't get away with that now. You know, like in the old days. See, if Bowie had run over me in his limo, I would have been perfectly happy just to be kind of crushed by the wheel. But now it's almost like there's kind of like these really fixed rules about what you can do. And fans are so, they're all in your grill, to quote Missy Elliott. They know everything about what you're doing. They know what you're doing next week. Do you think some of that fantastic sort of romance and mystery has really gone from sort of rock and roll and music?
Yeah, terribly. I think mystery has gone from stardom, whatever stardom may be, and I think that it will go back because of this. I look at, there's some magazine and it had a big zoom picture of Jennifer Lopez picking her nose, and then somebody cellulite and they're taking photographs up the wazoo, and somebody with hairs in their ear, and it's going to drive these megastars into complete seclusion, like it was in the 30s when there was movie goddesses and movie gods. They didn't go out among the public. They were gods and goddesses, and they had their own enclaves in the Hollywood Hills, and their homes were built particularly to entertain all the famous people, and they moved only in an isolated community. They were never seen, and this overexposure and almost rape of people's privacy and sensibility will drive people in the A-League into seclusion. It can only go on so far, can't it, really?
What do you think about sort of the current pop scene? You know, I mean, obviously, we talked about this when we saw each other out, and we both sort of said that, you know, sort of my dislike of it personally is not that I dislike the people.
I don't dislike
it. It's the whole kind of, you know,
it's the industry.
It's the whole method. I mean, what do you think will happen in the future? Where do you think things are going to go?
I think that the music industry has made tremendous amounts of progress, all of it downhill. And I consider it will never get better. I can remember being dissatisfied in the 80s, thinking things are going to get better, and they got worse in the 90s. I remember the 90s thinking things are going to get better, they got worse. I just see it as going to go worse and worse, and pop has eaten itself, hasn't it? And what can be more problematic to a record company or a manager or a producer than a three-dimensional artist who says, I want to do this, and this is how I want to do it, and this is what I've written? What can be more problematic? No, go away. Come in for 5 minutes, do the vocal, go to Pineapple Dance Studios with a load of dancing boys, and we deliver the tape when we see fit. And go out and smile at everyone, and we're going to give you a nice flat, and we're going to send a car for you, and we're going to have somebody come and bring you some nice Topshop clothes. And they think they've landed in paradise. But then when maybe they don't have a hit, and all those little things are taken away, they won't know how they got them, will they?
Exactly. I mean, do you think sort of having the success that you had in the 80s, like myself, has kind of made you a bit more realistic about...
I know how I got there, because I was on the indie band scene rehearsing every day.
You got there because you were fierce.
Yeah, but I know how I was just in a band, you know, and I rehearsed every day of the week, and then we put out some indie singles. Then you came to prominence, and record companies were looking for another Boy George. And because I had long hair, it's all, you know, it's just all surface, and everyone said, get him, he'll be the new Boy George. And we took the deal because it was a nice amount of money, and they said, you got to go in and do an album. And we did this album that was like a hardcore dance album, and they just thought, well, we'll wait for this to go away and wait for the ballad because we've got another Boy George here. They were very eager to not have two of you, or another record company wanted one of you. The way there's Britney Spears and
Christina Aguilera. And...
Yeah, they want the same thing, and it was very much the same then, but I knew how I'd got there, and I did get a certain status that's comfortable, and they couldn't really take anything away from me. And I still feel like that. You know, I'd like a hit record because I think I'm more equipped to deal with it and understand. I want to understand things that I didn't learn then. But if it doesn't happen, it just doesn't happen.
We're going to listen to some music now from Pete, and we're back for more take a look at London's roads now with LBC's Lisa Bates.
Thanks very much. Well, it's still a busy picture on the motorways this bank holiday Saturday. Starting on the northbound M1, still very slow from Junction 5 after an accident blocked the northbound exit slip of the Watford North Junction. That's number 6. Traffic's still being diverted to Junction 8 and then south to Junction 6 as a result. Got another smash causing heavy traffic further north between Junctions 8 and 9. If you're heading onto the Essex stretch of the M25, that's very slow going between Junctions 31 and 1. That's clockwise on the approach to and over the QE2 bridge. 10 miles per hour as you head onto the bridge itself. Very busy pictures still on a number of major routes as well. The Blackwall Tunnel has just the one lane open southbound after an accident involving a diesel spill earlier at the southern exit. Still taking a bit of a while to clear. Probably best advice to use the Dartford Tunnel for your river crossing if you want to avoid the queues. Still a bit busy around the Rotherhithe Tunnel. Queues built up there earlier with a couple of breakdowns. If you're crossing the river further east, a reminder that Borough High Street's very slow, so London Bridge is not a good idea. Temporary lights at the Southwark Street Junction. LBC 97.3 Travel, your next update in 30 minutes.
Saturday afternoon from 3, Roland Riveron and Janice V.
You don't like cats and dogs?
No.
I reckon it must stem from childhood. You must have had an unpleasant experience.
You think my mother might have hit me with a dog?
I don't know.
For plenty of babble and nonsense, join Roland Riveron and Janice V. Saturday afternoon from 3, LBC 97.3. Tuned in to London. Are you fed up with sitting in seedy clubs hoping to meet that someone special?
All right, darling, fancy drink? Me too. I'll have a pint now.
Give LBC Connections a call. It's the fun way to meet new friends. The best place to find that special someone. LBC Connections. Like-minded people looking for like-minded fun. Call 08000 859 379. The all-new LBC Connections. For people like you. Discover Airside with BAA Retail at Stansted, Heathrow and Gatwick. And you could fly away with more than great bargains on perfume, fine wine, spirits and other goods.
LBC 97.3 and BAA Retail are giving you the chance to win day trips to Paris with £100 spending money and £250 to spend Airside. Just listen to LBC 97.3 this Saturday, Sunday and Bank Holiday Monday and you could be flying to Paris.
So make time before your flight to shop with BAA Retail and start packing your bags for Paris with LBC 97.3. Tuned in to London.
Welcome back to And Another Thing, and I'm chatting with Pete Burns. Now, we just listened to a new mix of Spin Me Round.
Mm.
I did this sort of big 80s tour about 3 years ago, and because we were last on, I got to sort of hear all the other bands from the dressing room. And I noticed that every band had one song that was like a ball and chain. It was like Heaven 17 was Temptation, Belinda Carlisle was Heaven is a Place on Earth, Human League was Don't You Want Me, ours was Karma Chameleon. How do you... I mean, obviously, I think it's a brilliant record. It's one, yeah. I think it's one of those records that will keep your money forever. It's, like, yeah. It's almost like... It's like In the Summertime, that yeah. record. It's like a sort of very campy disco song like that. And every time you hear it, you just... I don't know, you just, it feels like an old jumper.
We can all moan about it being a ball and chain, but I think ultimately everybody wants to have one, and we got one. I got one, you got one. And
oh, yeah, I mean, I used to hate Karma Chameleon, but I got over that.
And yeah, and then you realise, and you just go through it, because, I mean, look at Judy Garland with Over the Rainbow, or Liza Minnelli with Cabaret, that they weren't, you know, they were just songs that they sung, but you do get one that everyone latches onto, and it's just, it happens, and I do feel lucky that it did happen.
Do you feel, though, that having such a big record, like, same with me with Karma Chameleon, because people always refer to that. I mean, look, recently Nina Simone passed away and people were saying, oh, she's known for My Baby Cares For Me, which is her least favourite song. I mean, I love her, so I know that she's got extensive catalogue. Yeah. But do you feel that having a hit like that and having the success you had in the past kind of makes people think of you constantly in past tense?
Of course, and you're very aware that sometimes you do a show and you do like maybe 11 songs and everyone's just waiting to do Spin Me, and they'd be a lot happier if you did Spin Me 11 times. But I think that anything, any fool out there who thinks they're going to get into a creative job, be it art or music, there is no particular variation, you find a formula, and that's what you become known for. I think Andy Warhol would have been so much more respected if he just carried on painting the soup can, but he wanted to do other things. But when people think of Andy Warhol, most of the people I know think of the Campbell's soup can, and he did a lot of other really interesting things. And it's the same with music. You go into music and think, okay, I'll have a few hit records, and then I'm going to play them my new stuff, folks. And it's not like that. In punk days, it was. You didn't have an album out. You went out and did your new material, but now it's not like that.
Well, I think you can do that if you stop playing the game the same way. You know, if you accept that you might not have as big success that you know as you had in the past. I think, because for me, obviously, in this country, it's the same thing. I don't get played on Radio 1. And I did the very stupid thing of writing a song about it and putting it on the internet.
So they're punishing you forever.
A million listeners can't be wrong. Switching off, not switching on. You know, it's very personal. But I got to the point where I thought, you know what, they're not playing my records. They played me for 15 years. You know, they didn't play the last Culture Club single, even though it went in at number 4. I thought, you know, I don't care. I don't
it
need
went
them
in at number 4.
Yeah, I don't need to. It. Yeah, and I don't need them to make a living. I don't, you know, I do other things.
Yeah.
Pretty much like yourself, you know, you've got, you know, you're resourceful. That's, I mean, do you think that comes from being like, you know, a scally, you know, that kind of, you know.
It comes from the punk days. It just comes from the, I didn't want to be a hairdresser, but when I was 14, I'd bluffed my way into a hair salon because it was the only place that you could dress up for work, and I had no interest in doing people's hair. But once I'd destroyed a few people's hair, actually, I went to the King's Road and discovered Vivian Westwood, Malcolm McLaren's. It was Let It Rock then, and I started to buy the clothes. And then when it turned to sex, I had the clothes, and I'd go to work in the salon. So they said to me, you can't come to work wearing those clothes. But I didn't have any other clothes, you see. So they fired me, and I sued them for unfair dismissal. My father did. And with the compensation that I got, I thought, well, what can I do now? I can buy more clothes, or I can do something clever. So I found vintage outlets for things like Beetle Boots and things like that, and bought them and set up a little shop. And then all the people from London, like Acme Attractions and everything, were coming up to Liverpool to buy this vintage stuff. And then from the attention that that clothes shop brought to me, going to Eric's and wearing all of this Vivian Westwood clothes, the guy who ran Eric's said, if you don't form a band, you can't come in next week. And he stuck to his word and he didn't let me in for 2 weeks.
Trying to get that confident. It was really interesting, that.
So he said, you can't come in. You're wearing all this traditionary stuff. You're a star. You form a band or you're not coming in. I thought, oh, don't be silly. I don't want to be in a group. I'm selling clothes around the corner. But he took pity on me and put a band together, and I ended up in a band, and it just snowballed from there. So I don't know if it's resourceful or that I feel like I've just thrown myself down a big tube and things happen on the way.
And obviously back in those early days, you knew people like Ian McCulloch and
he hated me, I didn't know him.
Oh my God.
To me.
He said something really funny about me in the 80s. He said that I should be sent to the army.
He hated me.
Right, because I'll tell you this great story, the perfect revenge, because he was always saying things about me. And, you know, he always kind of came across as this sort of, you know, like, punky, wasn't vain. And I was at this thing, it was like a charity event for the rainforest, and I'd gone down to this area where you could smoke. And there was a big bathroom, you know, there was sort of like the guy sitting there with all the shampoos and the aftershaves and stuff.
Okay, yeah.
And I sort of walked past and I saw Ian McCulloch desperately trying to tease what little hair he had left up into these spikes. And I leaned in and I went, isn't revenge beautiful? And he laughed. But yeah. I do actually think he's a brilliant songwriter. And
I love the
singer.
Bunny Man, but that Liverpool scene of the music as well, I just wasn't welcome. They were all so serious in the grey raincoats and they didn't take to me and my traditionary clothes and things. I wasn't welcome. They wouldn't talk to me. I couldn't be friends with them. I was completely isolated.
Do you think the punk thing was quite homophobic?
Not when it began. I wouldn't even say the word homo came into it. It was just queers. And queers, to me, the definition of queers is just people who think differently and are open to different experiences. And I wasn't allowed into gay clubs. And it turned out better because I was going to Eric's and it was just these different people. So there was no homophobic. Men were kissing men, women were kissing women. People were going home and sleeping together, and it was all very exciting. And homosexuality and didn't come into my consciousness.
Now you're married, which might sound odd to people.
I know, but why? Just because I look like this?
No, I'm just saying that, you know, the average person, it doesn't bother me.
I'm not saying it's your opinion. I'm just saying.
I think it's kind of, you know, when I heard that, I was like, really? You know, this is years ago. I was like, well, and then I met Lynn, you know.
Yeah, but
and
you know,
realised why you married her, because she's just a couple of sticks.
But, you know, it's like also David and Angie Bowie were married, and I can remember growing up and thinking, well, I look this way, but it doesn't mean that I've got to go into this other. Like, I can have everything, really. I never believe in somebody. You know, someone says they're gay or someone says they're straight, well, you never really know forever. That's like saying I've got brown hair today, and in 10 years you're going to have grey hair. You don't know how life changes you, do you?
Yeah, because I think a lot of people view morality and sexuality in the sense that it's not transient, and I think it is.
It's very transient.
Because the morality of 100 years ago is no longer applicable now, you know, and I think the same with sexuality. I mean, you know, when I meet a guy who comes up and talks to me, and they're obviously flirting, and then they say, I'm straight, I'm like, I don't remember asking you if you were. What's that got to do with it anyway?
I wish I was as quick on that as you are, and listen to how articulate you are today. You know, you say some things that are just absolutely amazing, and it's really, really true. You're much better with words than I am, because sometimes I can't be bothered, you know. And I really don't know where you get time to think and form these opinions, because you are so busy, you're almost hyperactive.
It's that thing, what's it, that Gemini thing, roses are red, violets blue, I'm schizophrenic and so am I. I think the Gemini thing, I saw Richie Havens playing about 2 years ago, and he did this whole thing about the astrology chart. And he was going like, Gemini, I feel, if only everybody felt what I feel. What star sign are you?
Leo.
Oh,
I wouldn't say that I was a typical Leo either when I read these horoscopes and things. I wouldn't say I was a typical Leo. I'm not really a leader. Leaders are very... No, I'm not really a leader. If things aren't my way, well, I don't...
Think I would describe you as a leader of your own army, and it might only contain one person, but that's pretty that's pretty important.
I don't boss people around. It's just if... I'm not... I haven't got tenacity. If things aren't going my way, I have nothing to do with it. I don't say, right, this is the way it's going to be. I just think it's not my way. I'm not happy. I'm going somewhere else.
So, an interesting question. I mean, obviously, you know...
I'm cold, excuse
me. Oh, sorry. I thought you were leaving.
No, what is going on? Hold on. I think I'm going into... sugar shock.
In terms of your career, are there things that you just will not do?
God, yeah, there's plenty of things that I wouldn't do. I've got no urge to go on a major world tour. I have these incredible debates with management because I would rather play in clubs, even if it's a track date with live vocals and some live keyboards. I'd rather play in a club than go and play a stadium. I don't want to become one of those stadium people. And I think things are really changing now. I don't know who these people are, but there's somebody called Fisher Spooner.
And I read
they played at the ICA and they do these very small things.
I've seen
and
them, they're very
it's
good.
Very, very visual. And for some reason, I thought, that is what's about to happen. That is, and it's almost like David Bowie's 1984 floor show. It was three nights in the marquee where people aren't moving around and it's maybe filmed and put on TV.
I went to see them, actually, Royal Festival Hall about 2 years ago, and it was hysterical. So I was standing in the sort of stalls and they started performing with all these fantastic girls, you know, in these kind of big sort of pompadour wigs and stuff. And the guy looked, it was quite sort of Ziggy-ish, you know, with sort of like no top on, very tight jeans. And this guy in front of me pulled out this megaphone and started going, "You're rubbish, you're miming, get off." And I thought he was being abusive, so I went to grab him.
He's part of the show.
So anyway, don't, he's part of the show. And it was brilliant. It was so funny because he crawled across the crowd and was on the stage. It was so funny.
I was excited to read about those kind of things happening. And whatever this definition of electro clash is, I think it's very exciting in those clubs. I love Nag Nag and I went to the one called Cock. And I just think it's really exciting to see people just making their own alternative scene. It really reminds me of the summer of 76. I don't know if I'm as optimistic as I was then. I don't know if it'll have such a big impact on society. But it is nice to see something start like that.
I actually think you're right, because I think that there is a feel of that kind of early acid house vibe to this electro thing. And I also think a good indication is when dance magazines are slagging something off.
Yeah,
because they never get it right.
There is hostility towards this new scene, and I can't even tell you what the definition of the music is. I don't know, but all I know is when you walk into somewhere like that, it's filthy, your shoes get ruined, there's people sweating all over you. But I accept that, because that's what I started off in, you know.
Life is always more beautiful at the other side of the velvet rope.
Yes, it is, but I do like the velvet rope as well. But eventually I started to go out and I was in VIP lounges and I'd had, like, the lovely velvet rope. And eventually I think I'm really bored in here. I'm not seeing anything but other VIPs.
And also, you never get to meet anybody. That's the whole point of going out, isn't it?
Yeah, but that in itself can be stressful, because sometimes it would be nice to go out and just look. And that can be very, very difficult. But I can't complain. But I do have an optimism that there's something like the new... We always say the new punk. There'll never be another punk, will there? But there is something out there happening that might have an impact on youth culture. Because youth culture's got nothing, has it?
I know, it's very depressing. Let's hope that there's something to look forward to. Pete, thanks so much for doing the show. You are a star.
Oh, thank you, George. I really loved it. So anyone who's tuning in to see if we're going to bash each other on the head with something, they must be really bored. They can switch off now.
Now, if you didn't love him before and you don't love him now, then you've really got problems. Goodbye. We've been acting strange.